It is a privilege once again to come around for Bible study this evening, and we are trusting God that the Lord is going to move us forward again in His knowledge in the name of Jesus Christ. You are welcome. Let's pray together. Father, we want to thank you for this privilege you have given to us again today to come and dig into your word. Thank you. We give you praise for all you have been teaching us. And we thank you in advance that this evening will not be an exception. You are going to reveal yourself to us in a new dimension again in your word. In the name of Jesus, we are pleading with you that you will lead us straight away to that which you want to emphasize that we need to add to our lives, as we are trusting you that you will make us mature in your knowledge this evening in the name of Jesus Christ. Grant us understanding, give us insight, give us revelation, give us the adequate utterance to convey this message to everyone, to your children from far and near this evening in the name of Jesus. Teach both the teacher and the listeners in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, we continue in our studies on Christian maturity today by the special grace of God, and we are going to straight away move into the verse 6 of our text. Remember, we have been studying from the 2 Peter chapter 1, and that is from verses 3 to 9. And we have been looking at those ingredients that were mentioned or itemized in their order of necessity in Christian maturity. So we have considered two of them, and that is in verse 5, and that is goodness and knowledge. So we move to verse 6 today in our study. So I would like you to quickly follow us as I read or we read together 2 Peter chapter 1. I will only read the place of our concentration today, then before we go ahead and read some other passages in our studies quickly this evening. All right, but let me read for understanding from verse 5. It says, "For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge." Then in verse 6, it says, "And to knowledge self-control." And to self-control, perseverance, and to perseverance, godliness. Now we are going to concentrate on that first part of verse 6 that says, "And to knowledge self-control." Now that should tell you straight away what we are looking at tonight, that the next ingredient or the next step on the ladder of Christian maturity according to this arrangement of God is self-control. You remember that last week we looked at knowledge, that knowledge of God must be added to the virtue or to goodness, must be added to Christian virtue, and that without God's knowledge, a virtue on its own becomes self-righteousness. It becomes ordinary morality. It becomes what we do without or what we can do without having the proper knowledge of the Lord. So our emphasis was that knowledge of God, the personal knowledge of God, is very, very important as we grow in maturity, as we cultivate a good character. That good character must be based on the knowledge of the Lord. So today we see in this order that knowledge on its own is not going to be enough, that there is still something that needs to be added to knowledge in the life of every child of God. Now, we say that the problems that we always, or the areas that we always have problem, is the area of knowledge. Many people they have good character and so on, but they don't have their character, their zeal is not based on knowledge. It's ordinary. It's not based on the correct knowledge of God. And we said several people get stuck in this area. However, as good as knowledge is, if one has acquired knowledge, even the knowledge of God, or any knowledge, as we are going to see tonight, that is not going to be enough if the person is going to grow or is going to move into the next step in the ladder of Christian maturity. So we are trying to look at it tonight, that knowledge on its own is not enough. No, so we find out the reason as we move forward this evening in the name of Jesus Christ. Now, we are going to be looking at 2 points this evening. That means our study is divided into 2 points. Number one, the importance of knowledge. Why is knowledge so important in the life of every child of God or everybody? The importance of knowledge. Then secondly, we are going to be looking at the management of knowledge. If knowledge is important, it must be managed. It must be managed if someone must move forward, as we look at our study this evening. The management of what? Of knowledge. That is why self-control, as we have identified in our reading there, that self-control is what the Bible says should be added to knowledge. So why is self-control, why is it needed to be added to our knowledge? And that's where we are saying we are going to be emphasizing the management of knowledge. That is, why do we need to manage knowledge? Importance of knowledge. Let's quickly go straight away and provide answer to this question that we see in our first outline. That why is it so important? Why is it that God, you know, decide to say that we need knowledge as a way of, you know, trying to push a bit forward in our last studies that we were talking about the knowledge of God, that it must be added to our virtue. Knowledge is so important. Now let's quickly read first Isaiah chapter 5. In Isaiah chapter 5 we see something there that makes knowledge so important in the life of every child of God or every believer. Now Isaiah chapter 5 verse 13, the Bible says, therefore my people will go into exile. Now mark the word my people. Say they will go into exile for lack of understanding. Their men of rank will die in hunger, and their masses will be parched with thirst. Now, the first thing that we are seeing here is that knowledge is so important that lack of it will take people into exile, takes people into bondage. Look at as that scripture is saying there. It says, for lack of understanding or lack of knowledge, we can put it that way, for their ignorance. You see, they will go into exile. In other words, knowledge protects someone from going into captivity, going into bondage. When knowledge is not available, so definitely according to the scriptures here, people will go into bondage. Now we can testify to that truth, that there are several people that are in trouble today as a result of lack of knowledge, as a result of ignorance, especially of the truth that will set their lives free. It is the ignorance of several people that those people that have advantage are, you know, capitalize on to cheat them. You know, it is the, as long as someone remains in darkness, those who can see will rule over him. And that's what happens all over the places, both in the church, in the nation, in economy, in every aspect of life. As long as people know more than you or know what you are supposed to know and you don't know it, they will enslave you. They will put you under. And until you get knowledge, before you are able to challenge, you know, their authority. So, if you read the book of Hosea, let's read Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. Hosea chapter 4, verse 6 also says, my people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. That's Hosea chapter 6, chapter 4, verse 6. He said, my people. Remember, Isaiah also said, my people. Now, you can see that it doesn't matter whoever lacks knowledge, whether the person is a believer or is a, you know, what have you, anybody. Now for God also now to say, my own people, that it's not only those who maybe are not religious people that lack of knowledge will destroy or will affect. It affects even the so-called people of God also. See, my people are destroyed from lack of knowledge. Destruction. You can see, say, because you have rejected knowledge, I also reject you as my priest. He said, because you have ignored the law of your God, I will ignore your children. That's rejection. Now, look at that now. Now, see, lack of knowledge, not only that it sends someone into bondage, into exile. Now, it brings rejection. God is saying here that because you have rejected knowledge, he said, I will reject you as my priest, and I will also reject your children. That's rejection. Now, not only that, he said, my people are destroyed. Now, look at that now. We have identified bondage. Now, we see another one, rejection. Then the final one is what? Eventual destruction. You can see lack of knowledge is so much important that lack of it, you know, throws a man into what? Number one, bondage. Number two, it can make God to reject the person. Not only the person, even the whole generation. Then it will result into eventual destruction. Now you can see the impact of knowledge in the life of everyone, everybody, anybody, mention the anyone, whether believer or non-believer, you just need to seek knowledge. Knowledge, like some people will say, is power. You can see it here because it is the instrument that one can use to liberate himself. How much more when it is now the knowledge of God? How much more if somebody knows God? If somebody, after having possessed every other knowledge, exposures here and there, then the person is now, now possessed the knowledge of the Holy, the knowledge of the Holy One, which the Bible calls understanding. You can see how far the person will go in everything. He or she does. So knowledge is very, very, very important for you and I, because we cannot afford to remain in the dark. And that is why every child of God should seek wisdom, seek knowledge in everything you do. Seek knowledge in your business, seek knowledge in your studies, seek knowledge. In your career, seek knowledge. In what is happening around you, in your environment, seek knowledge. Get knowledge. The Bible says, wisdom is the principal thing. It said, in all thy getting, get understanding. So you just discover that in this life, one cannot just be ignorant. We can't just continue to be novice, Like we said the other time, that as long as someone is ignorant of his right, those who have the knowledge of that right will continue to deny him of the right. Because he doesn't know. Even if they give him that right, he doesn't know the importance. So why giving it to him? And that's the state of several of us. That the devil continues to cheat us. He knows the provisions of God for us. But because we don't know it, then he continues to deal with us based on our ignorance. So you can see that it is very, very important. Knowledge of God. Knowledge of every kind, knowledge just make sure that we keep learning. Now we say that, how do we acquire knowledge? We acquire knowledge by learning. By learning from people, by learning from books, by learning, by reading, by studying, by observing people, by observing events, you know. And the knowledge of God comes by believing in Christ, by following Jesus, by studying Him. They will receive the knowledge of the Lord. So you and I cannot just do our lives. We can't just go ahead and live our lives without being knowledgeable, especially of the will and the counsel of God. That will lead us to point number two in our studies today, and that is management of knowledge. As good as knowledge is in the life of every believer, of every child of God, as important as it is, the Bible does not encourage us to stay there. It doesn't encourage us to just be knowledgeable people. It doesn't, but God is saying that, yeah, it's good to be knowledgeable in anything, in everything that you do. You just need to be knowledgeable, because nobody will listen to a fool. Nobody wants to take counsel from someone who is ignorant, somebody who doesn't know anything. Nobody respects an ignorant person. Nobody takes him serious. Oh yes. But as much as this is truth, then God is saying, yes, you still need to add something to your knowledge. Yes, it's good to know me. It's good to seek wisdom, to understand who God is, to know who God is. It's good to come to Christ. It's good to be knowledgeable about the Word of God, about the Scriptures. It's good to be knowledgeable about science, about money, about politics, about business, about anything. It's good to be knowledgeable. It's good to have facts about life. It's good to have facts even about God. It's good to have facts about the things of God. That's talking about knowledge. It's good to be broad, to be broad-minded. It's good, you know, not to be an ignoramus, not to be an ignorant person. It's good to be well-informed. It's good to be educated. Oh yes, but knowledge must be managed. If you want to grow, if we want to be mature as Christians. So that's the question we are asking ourselves in this second part of this study before we go and pray. Why do we need to manage knowledge? Or why do we need to add self-control to knowledge? If knowledge is good, what else do we need? If we understand God and we have acquired knowledge and we keep acquiring it, like someone we have people who have read several books, who have acquired several degrees, who have done well in all their studies, they keep doing that, and the knowledge is making them popular, is making the whole world to know them. Is there any need to manage such kind of knowledge? Yes. Then why do we need to do that? Now, if you read the message in that our text, and that is verse 6, you know, King James says temperance. In other words, you must be temperate with whatever you know. That's what King James says. And other translations like NIV says self-control. In other words, self-control must be added to knowledge. That no matter how knowledgeable someone is, he needs the virtue of self-control with that knowledge if he must be a mature human being. Now you can see what God is pointing at here. Now I begin to understand the reason why these things were actually arranged in this order. He didn't say you must have self-control first, then you go and acquire knowledge. No, he said no, knowledge comes first. Then when you acquire knowledge, you will see the need, the reason why you need to be temperate with what you know. That if you want to move up, then what that thing that you know, you must learn how to manage it. Now one of the problems that we experience today is several people are knowledgeable. We have knowledgeable Christians, people who are knowledgeable in their careers, they are knowledgeable maybe in politics, they are knowledgeable in science, they are knowledgeable in everything academic, they are very, very much knowledgeable. But the area of management, how to manage, how to control that knowledge, how to channel that knowledge correctly in a way that God will be pleased is the problem. How do you explain a knowledgeable professor that is running after small girls in schools? How do you explain a knowledgeable, man who is assisting students, in examination malpractices just because of money? How do you explain that? Well-educated person, but the knowledge cannot be controlled. The knowledge is not well managed. Something is lacking in that knowledge. Now, look at how the message in that word, that same word there, the message used, it says what should be added, that NIV calls self-control, is what the message calls it, alert discipline. That is all knowledge must be exercised with conscious discipline. In other words, no matter how knowledgeable that you are as a person, as an individual, you need to add conscious discipline. You need to be disciplined with that knowledge. You need to exercise that knowledge with discipline, or with fear and tremble. You need to be, there must be fear in your heart. And the fear we are talking about is the fear of God. Knowledge has made several people, some people as they were looking for knowledge, acquiring knowledge here and there, some of them have left God behind. You say, who is God? Is there anything that needs to be known that we don't know? So, such people are not conscious of the fact that there is someone that is called God, who is the source of all wisdom. So, they left him behind. But the knowledge that the Bible is saying, the kind of knowledge that is saying to us here, that is that the one that must be exercised with fear, with discipline. Proverbs 9 verse 10 says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. When is in other words, when there is fear of the Lord, we will learn knowledge management and control. What is it, the fear of the Lord in our lives that we add to knowledge that will assist us in how to manage that knowledge, how to use it wisely, how to control it, that that knowledge will not become an instrument of destruction in our lives. And that is what the Bible calls wisdom. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. To anyone who knows how to control knowledge, anyone who knows how to apply knowledge, anyone who knows how to, you know, channel his knowledge towards correct direction, who knows how to discipline himself no matter how knowledgeable he or she is a wise person. Knowledge that is, you know, that is not, that is without discipline, it's like a car without a brake. You know, when somebody is knowledgeable, but there is no discipline in his knowledge, he doesn't, his knowledge is cannot tell him that, look, you need to be conscious, you need to be careful, you need to discipline yourself, you need to be afraid, you need to be to tremble, you need to, you know, to be conscious of the fact that you can still make a mistake. Now, such kind of a knowledge is like a car without a brake. No brake, no control. So, knowledge should be exercised with discipline. It should be exercised with self-control. You must not forget the fact that God is the source of all knowledge. Then why do we need to do this? Why do we need to add self-control to our knowledge? Now, let's begin to find out the reason, one or two or three reasons, then we will pray at this end. In 1 Corinthians chapter 8 and verse 1, Paul wrote here, look at what Paul said. Now about food sacrificed to idols, we know that we all possess knowledge, but knowledge puffs up while love builds up. Now what you just need to emphasize here is that, look, Paul also recognized the fact that he was, you know, the people he was addressing, they say, I say, I know you are knowledgeable people, that there is nothing I want to say that you don't know. You are knowledgeable. But I know that all of us are knowledgeable people. All of us have gone to school. All of us can say one or two things about this matter. He said, but knowledge puffs up. You see, knowledge has the ability to make somebody, you know, pompous, to puff somebody up, just like a tire that is pumped up. When you see a tire, you know, you press it, it's very hard, but no matter how hard or strong that tire looks like, the content is ordinary air. Let that air be deflated and you discover that the strength that you see in that tire is an artificial, you know, strength. Now, knowledge can be something like that in a man, that the knowledge, you know, pumps a man up, puffs him up, you know, he looks as if he's a big person. It seems as if the person is on top of the world. Knowledge can lift a man, you know, artificially to that point. And that's what Paul was saying here, that look, one can easily be, you know, be proud because of his knowledge. Knowledge is so subtle that if it is not controlled, it can turn a man, you know, it can make a man to look at himself above others. You know, There are several people that, because of the knowledge that they possess, they look down on people. They look down on anybody. What do you know? Sit down there. When I am talking, you don't talk. Why? It is knowledge. Because they believe that they know more than those people. So knowledge can easily, you know, make someone to be too proud or to be proud. And that is the reason why Paul was saying it. It's a knowledge needs to be controlled. No matter how knowledgeable you are, brother, no matter how knowledgeable, even in the things of God, we have brothers that are proud based on the knowledge they have in the things of God, even in the word of God. You know, you have knowledge more than other people. You have knowledge of the scriptures. You have knowledge about God. You have gifts of the Spirit more than other people. If you are not careful, you can be proud. Look at what Paul says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12. Let's read from 1 to 6. You will see there. So Paul managed his own depth of knowledge with discipline. He wrote, look at it now from verse 1. He said, I must go on boasting, although there is nothing to be gained. I will go on to visions and revelations from the Lord. That's talking about his knowledge. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up in the third heaven, whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, but God knows, was caught up to paradise and had inexpressible things that no one is permitted to tell. I will boast about a man like that, but I will not boast about myself, except about my weaknesses. Verse 6 says, even if I should choose to boast, I will not be a fool, because I will be speaking the truth. But I refrain, so no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say. Now, so Paul tried to manage his knowledge. Look at the account here. See, I know a man, and talking about himself, that even despite all the depth, all this insight that I have, I can boast. I have every reason to boast. He said, but no, there is no need to do that. See, I can only boast in my weakness. I can only consider my weaknesses, that I am still a man. I don't need to see myself as a spirit. Even despite the fact that I have had, I have experienced what you cannot express, you know, in the kind of the wealth of understanding, those things that cannot be expressed, you know, to ordinary thing, you know. So Paul didn't begin to carry himself as a spirit, as someone that people should be worshipped, just because of the experience, just because of the knowledge that he has possessed, you know, from the Lord. Let's learn how to manage whatever revelation, whatever knowledge, whatever experience that we might have had in our walk with God. We need to learn how to control it so that we will not be proud. Knowledge has the tendency to make a man proud. We have seen that in the lives of several people who do not know God. In our schools, in the secular, in the world, in businesses, we see people. Why is it that these people is like, in, why is he talking like this? And then you say, ah, he's a professor of this. You say, so when a professor is talking, everybody need to be silent. Say, ah, that is true. And but you see, in God, in Christ, we are not permitted to do that. That no matter how knowledgeable we are, we need to control it. We need to be self-controlled. We need to be disciplined with it. We need to be afraid. We need to fear God. We need to recognize God as the source of all knowledge. Now, please note that Galatians 5:22-23. You can read it. Is, you know, you can see that self-control is one of those fruit of the Spirit is there. But you must also be aware that knowledge is not there. Knowledge is not listed in that list. But do knowledge is necessary for living. It's necessary for living, but it's not a fruit of the Spirit. Like we have said, that we can get to know the Lord, we can get to know things, we can get by studying, by learning. Are you getting it now? But where we now need to really, really manage it is self-control. That when that knowledge comes in, oh, I have gotten to know the Lord because of all I took step, I study, I learn, I follow the Lord, I prayed, I study, and I've gone to acquire all this knowledge, whether in school and so on and so forth, and so on and so, knowledge will come. But you see, the fruit of the Spirit there is what? Self-control. That you need to manage it. You need to use it to balance it so that you can live a good life that God wants us to live. I think that is the reason why it must be exercised with control of the Spirit. Knowledge is necessary for living, but it must be exercised with control. And that comes from the Holy Spirit. That is why it is called self-control. Now, look at the Message Bible, how the Message Bible puts it in Galatians 5 and verse 23. Look at how it renders it in verse 23 here. Now, it said, not needing to force our way in life. That's talking about, that's gentleness. But look at what he now uses for self-control. He said, able to marshal and direct our energies wisely. Self-control is the ability to do what? To use, to direct, to manage, and to direct our energy wisely. And you can see that knowledge produces energy. When you get the knowledge about something, something rises up in you. It produces energy. It produces power. You say, yeah, I know this thing. Then you begin to see those who don't know it as ignorance. Now, that is where self-control comes in by the Spirit. Now, so you need ability to do what? To use it now wisely. Because that knowledge has produced energy in you. But inability to now use that knowledge, that, you know, that energy, that knowledge has produced in you is a problem. And that is where several people have problem. They are knowledgeable, but they are not able. They don't know how to manage, how to be disciplined as a result of the knowledge that they have, and pride setting into their lives. Now another reason why knowledge needs to be controlled, that knowledge needs to be exercised with discipline, is that it can lead one to a reprobate mind. Romans 1:20 says, as long as They refuse to retain God in their knowledge. The God leaves them to a reprobate mind. In other words, the mind that, you know, a reprobate mind is like a dull spirit. You know, God just abandoned them because they refused. They have knowledge, but they do not retain God in that knowledge. You can see that when knowledge is too much, you have acquired this, you have acquired this. This is the age of knowledge. But brothers, we need to give room for God in that knowledge. That is where the control is. That is where proper management of knowledge, of whatever you might have learned, comes in. You need to give room. You need to retain God in your own knowledge. Don't allow knowledge to push God out of your mind. If that happens, God may leave that person to a reprobate mind, and the person will be doing what is not right. He will be doing wrong, and he will see it as if it is good. Wrong will become right for the person, and that is what we experience in our society today. Several people are knowledgeable, but they are doing what is wrong, but they don't see anything wrong in what they are doing. That is why you see a knowledgeable person. A knowledgeable person committing an offense and is still defending himself. Committing, doing what the whole world, everybody knows that this is an offense. But he's still defending himself that no, it is not. Because of knowledge. Because of knowledge. So you can see that is a reprobate mind. He's not going to feel guilty again. There won't be sense of guilt in their lives, in the life of that person any longer. Anything he does is right. Even if people are saying, this thing that you are doing, is against the, you know, they say, no, what do you mean? What do you know? The conscience will be dead. The person, so that's it now. So if knowledge is not channeled properly, it's not controlled, it's not managed in the ways of the Lord, through self-control, that's what we are talking about. That's where self-control comes in. You add it to your knowledge. So people of God, we have seen this evening that knowledge is good, but it must be managed properly. It must be managed in line with the will and the purpose of God. It must be controlled. Knowledge that is controlled is what will produce maturity in you. That's what will make you grow. But the knowledge that is not controlled, knowledge of any kind, even if it is a knowledge of God, if it is not channeled towards the will of God, it will be like a car without brake. Accidents can occur at any point in time because there is nothing to hold the car back. There is nothing to put a stoppage. So it is with us. If we have all this knowledge, but we do not have self-control to it when it matters most, if we allow the knowledge to keep puffing us up, it's going to be unto destruction. I am praying that the Lord is going to help us. 1 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 7 says, what do you have that you have not received? That's the question I am concluding with us this evening. Brother, sister, what do you have? Do you have any gift of the Spirit? Do you have any knowledge? Have you gone to acquire any knowledge anywhere? Do you have several degrees? Do you have several connections? You know several people? Well, we give God the praise for that. It can be channels to the glory of God. What do you have? What do you know that you have not received? Name those things. You receive them somewhere. You receive them from the Lord by the grace of God. Because if you are not alive, you will not be able to acquire all those things that you claim to acquire. All those things that you think have set you above others. Be careful. Now, Paul said in 2 Corinthians chapter 3 and verse 5 that our sufficiency is of God. Don't be sufficient in your knowledge. Don't see yourself as a sufficient man. Don't see yourself as a sufficient woman. Based on the knowledge you have acquired, there is no sufficient man on this earth. The only person that is sufficient in everything is our Lord, is God Himself. So why don't we need to be careful? Be controlled. Put some control in our lives as we follow the law. We need to be careful, especially some of us that claim to have acquired some knowledge from one knowledge or the other, from wherever. We need to annex our knowledge with that of God. We need to allow this virtue of self-control to always put us in order, to always remember that whatever that we might have learned, knowledge must be balanced with self-control. May the Almighty God help you and I in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, so that anytime people see us, though they see a knowledgeable person, they see a Christian that is doing well, that is sound, yet they will see a man who is disciplined, a disciplined person, a man that is retaining God in his own knowledge, a man that has not pushed God out of his thinking, a man that doesn't seek evil and prove that it is right. No, they will see a man that call evil evil, and a man that call good good, a man that will be able to balance his knowledge with self-control. May the Lord help you and I today in the name of Jesus Christ. Let's pray at this point. Father, we thank you for this time, for this opportunity again, for us to be able to push ahead, push forward in this your word. Thank you for your emphasis today that knowledge is good, but it must be controlled. It must be managed properly. That is wisdom. It must be managed. And that is why you said, to our knowledge, you must add self-control. It's like you are saying that we need break in some aspect of our lives. That we cannot just be going like that every now and then. We must keep coming to you. We must keep looking at ourselves and say, don't go too far. Don't go more than where we put you. Don't look at yourself as if you are the all in all. That every point we must keep coming back to you as the source of all knowledge, and we must keep appreciating the fact that you are the one. Knowledge comes from you. Lord, help us to continue to retain you in whatever we know. Don't allow knowledge to push you out of our hearts in the name of Jesus Christ. Continue to teach us. Continue to give us understanding about life, about yourself. But don't allow those knowledge to push us out, to push you out of our hearts in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.